Lord, saints.
Praise the Lord.
If you all would rise for prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we give you thanks, Lord. We lift your name, Father. We give you all the glory, all the honor and the praise. We magnify your name. Father, there's none like you, Lord. We just thank you. We thank you for all that you've done, Lord. We thank you for health and strength, Father. We thank you for being in the right minds, Lord. We thank you for this place called Abundant Love, Lord. We thank you that you just rain down on us, Lord. That you continue to guide us, Lord. And we just praise your name in the name of Jesus. Now we ask you, Lord, that you just bless us individually and collectively, Lord. Father, touch the person that's delivering the word, Lord. Give them a word to deliver to your people, Lord. Bless them right now in the name of Jesus. We ask, Lord, that you come into this place, Lord. Fill the room, Father, in the name of Jesus. Oh, we just thank you right now in advance, Lord. We can't thank you enough, Father. We glorify your name in the name of Jesus. Lord, we ask that you bless the leaders right now, Lord. Bless the angel of this house. Bless them right now in the name of Jesus. We ask that you bless the leaders. Father, bless the musicians. And Father, we ask that you bless the laity. Touch us right now. Give us an ear to hear and a heart to receive your word. And we'll be sure to give you all the glory and all the honor and all the praise in your Son Jesus' name. In your Son Jesus' name. In your Son Jesus' name. Thank God. Amen. And we'll be having our scripture by Deacon Kyle. Amen.
There we go. Good morning. We're going to be reading the scripture for today, Proverbs 4:23-27. And it reads, "Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Put away from thee a forward mouth and perverse lips, put far from thee. Let thine eyes look right on, and let thy eyelids look straight before thee. Ponder the path of thy feet, and let all thy ways be established. Turn not to the right hand, nor to the left. Remove thy foot from evil." That is Proverbs chapter 4:23-27. God have a blessing to the hearers, the readers, and also the doers of his word.
Amen.
Praise the Lord, church.
Praise the Lord.
As you all prepare to give, we're going to bring and have our announcements by evangelist Vera Drew.
Amen.
Praise the Lord, saints. Okay, come on, we need to be a little bit more joyful this week. Hallelujah. The Lord has been a blessing to us all week. And the reason I know that, because I see everybody here. Amen. Amen. Our announcements are as following. Of course, as you already know, we are not having our regular worship services, but our live streams are open for limited attendance. But we will observe social distancing and face mask guidelines. Our live stream times are Sundays, Sunday school, 9:30 a.m., morning worship at 11 o'clock a.m. On Wednesdays, we have our Disciples Academy Bible study at 6:30 p.m. Our archive streams are Abundant Love Church Facebook page, YouTube channel AL Ministries, and that's capital A, capital L. And on Monday mornings, we have Motivating Moments at approximately 8 o'clock a.m. Amen. Just a reminder, if you have a Kroger card or Amazon account, you can set up your accounts for part of the proceeds to be donated to the church. If you are not signed up with Kroger or Amazon Smile programs or need assistance in setting up, please inbox on Facebook or see Sister Natasha Hillier or Camilla Slaughter to get signed up.
Amen.
We will have church project day on next Sunday, August 29th, and Pastor will give you a little information on that later on. Amen. Our sick and recovery includes Reverend Philip Johnson and his wife Flora, Travion Hillier, Harmony Washington, and Darius Hillier. Let's keep them in our prayers. There were no birthdays listed. Amen. Our platforms include Facebook, Abundant Love Church, Instagram at Abundant Love, and Twitter at Abundant Love at ALMS Fort Wayne. If you would like to make a contribution to our church, you may do so using Cash App, which is $Abundant Love Church. That's capital A, capital L, and capital C. You may give through Givelify, Abundant Love Church. Our mailing address is Post Office Box 6577, Fort Wayne, Indiana, 46896. And if you happen to be in our vicinity, you may drop off your offering at 2615 New Haven Avenue, Fort Wayne, Indiana. These are all of our announcements. Please govern yourselves accordingly. At this time, let's put our hands together for the praise team as they come. Come on, come on. Hallelujah for the praise team.
morning. Hallelujah. Psalm says you gave me my hands. Hallelujah. To reach out to man. Hallelujah. To show him some love. Hallelujah. And your perfect plan. Hallelujah. Because, Lord, I'm available to you. Hallelujah. Lift your hands if you're available to the Lord on this morning. Just begin to magnify his name. Hallelujah.
Available.
More available.
More available.
storage is empty and I am available to you. Hallelujah. How many know that any day now, God is going to do what he said he was going to do? Look at your neighbor, say, neighbor. Any day now, God's going to do what he said he will do. Amen. Say amen for the choir.
He's gonna do it.
Keep the faith, keep believing, keep praying.
somebody, say he'll be right on time. Tell him again, say he'll be right on time. How many know he'll be right on time? How many know he's an on-time God? Yes, he is. Hallelujah. Come on, clap your hands one more time in this place. I know we're streaming, but we're here to have church. Amen. How many know he's an on-time God? Look over at your neighbor, wave at him, and say, he's an on-time God. Now answer them and say, yes, he is. Look at him again and say, he's an on-time God. Or answer him, say, yes, he is. Daddy, people say he may not come when you want him, but he'll be there right on time. He's an on-time God. Yes, he is. All right, clap your hands one more time. Certainly the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to how many generations? It endures to every generation, and because it endures to every generation, that includes you. Amen. And so the mercies of the Lord are far-reaching. The mercies of the Lord are everlasting. And once you are in the Lord's care, you are in the Lord's care forever. Amen. Amen. All right, God bless you. Thank you all for joining us today for this particular worship service. And I believe that anytime we get an opportunity to praise and worship God, we ought to give it our very best. And now let me ask you a question. If this was your last opportunity to praise the Lord, do you feel like you gave him your best? Do you feel like you could do better than you've done already? Well, listen, I'm going to give you a chance because it may be your last time. So this is your last opportunity to lift your voice and give God some praise. Come on now, lift your voice. Stand on your feet, open your mouth, and let's praise him. Let's give him glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody say hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on, God, clap your hands in here as fast as you can, hard as you can. Hallelujah, glory to God. Yeah. The Bible says, enter his gates with thanksgiving. Come into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him. Bless his name, for the Lord is good. For the Lord is good. Mercy is everlasting. And his truth endures to every generation. Amen. All right. Look at somebody, wave at them, say, God is worthy of all your praise. Look at somebody else, say, God is worthy of all your praise. Tell them, say, don't save any of it. Don't save. Don't save. Don't save any of it. Don't save. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. A lot of things in life you got to save. Amen. But you never save your praise. Any opportunity you get to give your praise, give it and give it all. Amen. I've been told that if you use your praise, he'll give you more praise to give him. Amen. Because the Lord inhabits the praises of his saints. All right, clap your hand one more time to have your seat. Amen. I'm just going to accept one announcement, and then it's time for the word of the Lord. We're going to get into the spirit to receive the word. Amen. Amen. The announcer mentioned earlier today about the fifth Sunday of this particular month being Church Project Day, and I just want to rehearse the projects that we have before you. We have a three-phase project that we're working on at the present time. Actually, it was a four-stage. First stage is actually done. We have repaired all of the awning and all of the gutter work. Amen. We have a cement man coming in. He's going to replace the defacing on the wall on the south side of the building. So we're looking forward to that being done. And then after that, we have two. Well, just ladies, raise your hand and say, thank the Lord. Amen. And you know what? You know what I found out? I found out if you take care of God's house, God will take care of your house. Amen. So we want to do right by the house of the Lord. Amen. We are presently receiving quotes for that cement work. We're going to try to get two for the price of one.
We're not only going to have that wall done, but that planter that somebody has hit and broken, we want to fix that planter and make it a stand so that we can put us a nice sign on that stand. How about that? That sound good? Amen. All right. Then, of course, after that, we're going to have professional painters come in, those that are knowledgeable about painting masonry. We need the right type of paint. It's an expensive paint, but the Lord gonna give us the best for less.
Yeah.
Amen. Yeah. Get that done, and then after that, we'll have the parking lot done.
Yeah.
Amen. So that's the reason we're having this particular project Sunday. We're doing it the fifth Sunday this month because this Sunday has five Sundays. But in the succeeding months, when we only have four Sundays, the fourth Sunday, amen, we're going to designate as Church Project Sunday. Amen?
Amen.
So whatever the Lord blesses you with that month, you can look at the increase at the end of the month, and then we can make a sizable contribution to the beautification of the church. Amen? Okay, all right, I'm done with that. And thank you for your contributions, not only those of you that are in the sanctuary, but those of you from other states and other cities and other areas. Certainly, we are most appreciative of your contribution, and we thank you for your support of the Abundant Love Ministries. Amen?
Amen.
All right, look at somebody, say, it's time to hear the word.
It's time to hear the word.
Amen. Man doesn't live by
bread
alone, but he lives how?
Every
he lives by every, how many words?
Every
word that proceeds. Where is it coming from? Out of the mouth of God. Amen. And certainly, we are happy to have this opportunity to receive the word. The Bible says, how can they hear without a preacher? And how can they preach except they be sent? Amen. And I want you all to know this morning, the word of the Lord is here because we have a sent preacher in the house today to break, amen, the word of the Lord to us. She is no stranger to us. In fact, she is part of us, even though she resides and has her occupation in another city in the state of Indiana. I want you all to know that she is a faithful supporter of the Abundant Love Ministries. Amen. And so the Lord sent her today all the way from the city of South Bend, Indiana, to come and break the word of the Lord to us. She is an accomplished preacher. Very learned in the word. She's an accomplished principal in the South Bend school system. Amen. Principal is a high school there. And so we're certainly glad, overjoyed to have her this morning. And so I'm going to ask every word carrier if you would stand on your feet today. And we're going to receive the word of the Lord by Minister Lisa Marie Richardson. Would you all receive her with a hearty amen?
Hallelujah, everyone. Hallelujah, everyone. Hallelujah, everyone. Let's just take a moment to put our hands in the air and thank God. Thank God for who he is. Thank God for what he's done. Thank God for what he will do. He's the Alpha and he's the Omega. He is the beginning and he is the end. And he's everything in between.
Around the saints of God.
It's always good to be around his people. Oh, thank you and bless your name. Bless your name.
Bless your name.
Bless your name. I want to give honor to the elders, the mothers, the ministers, all of my brothers and sisters in Christ. I want to give a special thank you and blessing to my daughter who drove us here all the way from South Bend. I thank you. We made it safe. And my son Malcolm, who made his way. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm going to read the scriptures while you're standing, and then you can have your seat. Proverbs 4, starting at the 23rd verse. Guard your heart. I'm reading from the New Living Translation. Guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life.
Yes.
Avoid all perverse talk. Stay away from corrupt speech. Look straight ahead and fix your eyes on what lies before you. Mark out a straight path for your feet. Stay on the safe path.
Yes.
Don't get sidetracked. Keep your feet from following evil.
Yeah.
That is the end of the scriptures, and you may have your seat. Praise your name. This book of Proverbs, it teaches us in an if-then system.
Yes.
If you do this, then this happens. When I read the text in isolation, when I just read those verses, I started wondering what I needed to guard my heart from. Right? We know that there's these issues in the world, but I wondered exactly what the psalmist was saying, because he said it over and over in chapter 4. So I started from the top of the chapter and realize the writer was speaking about guarding your heart and keeping that wisdom and understanding. So let's go to, we're going to stay in the fourth chapter, but go to the fourth verse. I'm going to read the fourth through the seventh verse for you. And it reads as follows. My father taught me, take my words to heart. Follow my commands and you will live. Get wisdom, develop understanding. Don't forget my words or turn away from them. Don't turn your back on wisdom, for she will protect you. Love her and she will guard you. Getting wisdom is the wisest thing you can do. And whatever else you do, develop understanding. So, he's telling us that we have to have this wisdom, and we have to have this understanding, and we have to guard it with our heart. We have to guard it with our heart. Above all else, it's more important than everything else. So then my mind went to, the question became, what is the wisdom and what is the understanding I must have? What is it? It's a lot of things that God has shared with us in the book to help us on this walk, to keep us holy on this walk, to keep our feet safe so we don't stumble and fall. But what particularly is it that the author wants us to know and understand? Because the author repeats this thing about guarding your heart over and over again. In verse 13, the author says things like, guard them, for they are the key to life. And then in verse 22, the author says, bring life to those that finds them and healing to their whole
body. So we know that when things are repeated over and over and over again, it's because of importance.
Yes.
It's because we want you to really know it. If you have children, before they start school, we always try to teach them their name, a phone number, their address, because we know they don't always get off on the right bus stop, or something may happen, and we want them to be able to tell somebody who they are, where they live, and who they can call. We don't just tell them one time, hey, this is your name, this is your address, this is your number, and then let them go about their business. We tell them over and over and over and over again, right? We remind our kids, make sure you check the stove before you, when you finish cooking, make sure you turn the stove off. Did you turn the stove off? Make sure you turn the stove off. How many of us have left home and had to go back because we couldn't even remember we turned the stove off? Me, right? Over and over and over. When we want our children to know something, we don't just tell it to them one time.
Right.
We tell it to them so many times, they say stuff like, yeah, I know what you're getting ready to say. And then they'll repeat what we have told them. And then we feel good because we're like, okay, now you know it, but now you also got to do it. Right? Over and over. So I'm like, this wisdom and this understanding that the author is talking about must be very important, because he keeps telling us that we got to guard our heart, that it's our life, it's for our body. So I'm like, okay, what is this? And Proverbs 23:7 lets us know our heart controls our mouth. Let's look at Proverbs 23:7. Let's go there.
Yeah.
So when we go to Proverbs 23. I'm coming, y'all. I'm coming. It didn't go to 23:7. It might have been my fingers, maybe not. Okay, 23:7. So 23:7 says, they are always thinking how much it costs to eat and drink. They say, but they don't mean it. That is not the verse I wanted. Hold on. Yes, Lord. It's going to make sense in a minute. Okay. So, I want to look at it in another version that uses the words that I wanted to use. So, the New King James Version. It says, for as he thinks in his heart, so is he. Eat and drink, he says to you, but his heart is not with you. So, as you think in your heart, is how you are. So our heart controls our mouth. And Proverbs 18:21 says in the King James Version, death and life are in the power of the tongue. And they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. So here in our foundational text, it talks about guarding your heart.
Amen.
And then our foundational text lets us know that we have to avoid all perverse talk. Why is it important to avoid perverse talk? Because what we think in our heart is what we say out of our mouth. And we know out of the mouth we can create. The scripture told us we can create death. And life.
Yes.
Death and life is in the power of the tongue.
Yes.
And they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. So this fruit is either good fruit or rotten fruit. You're either going to say these things that's going to bring life, or you're going to say these things that are going to bring death. So whatever we're holding in our heart is going to dictate what we say, and then that's going to create some things in our lives. So as I was pondering on this, I kept going back to, I know the types of things that the world wants us to put in our heart. We know the types of things that the world wants us to put in our heart. They want us to carry fear. They want us to carry envy. They want us to carry distrust. They want us to carry all of these negative things that will not make our path straight. Because when we carry it in our heart, then we start speaking about it. I don't trust so-and-so. I don't trust this one. I don't trust the vaccines. I don't trust that there's really corona out there. I don't believe. I don't trust. I don't this. I want to do my own thing. Right? That's the movement of the world. Right? That's the movement of the world. This is the law. I don't believe in that law. I'm not going to do that law. I'm going to go over here and do something else. No, this is the law of the land. This is the law of the land. And so we start then to build this momentum of people who are speaking some things that's contrary to what they should be speaking. And we don't want to be those people. Amen. In the NLT. So then let's go to, it says, that is why in verse 24 it says, avoid all perverse talk. Stay away from corrupt speech.
Yeah.
If it's not in the word, doesn't align to the word, we should not allow it to come out of our mouth.
Amen.
We should not allow it to come out of our mouth. And so we're going to talk a little bit further about, but these things are going on. We have trauma in our lives. We have trauma in this world.
Amen.
I work with children and they are traumatized. And I'm supposed to be teaching them to read and to write and to do math. And they're traumatized.
Yeah.
And think about when we have a lot of stress, we are easily distracted.
Yeah.
It's hard for us to focus on the things that we're supposed to focus on because we have this pressure and we have this stress that's going on.
Amen.
The word tells us that in spite of what's going on, Romans 4 and 17 says, we must speak what we know and not what we see. So let's go to Romans 4 and 17. Romans 4 and 17 in the KJV says, as it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations, talking to Abraham, before him whom he believed, even God, who quickened the dead and calleth those things which be not as though they are. I want to pause here because our text is telling us don't speak these perverse things. But what happens when perversity is in your life? What happens when things start going on in your home, at your job, with your health, and it doesn't align to what the promises of God says?
Yeah.
Romans 4 and 17 tells us that we got to call those things which be not as though they are. So it doesn't matter what's naturally going on. We got to call it from the spirit so that the future becomes the present.
Yeah.
See, that's the thing that we have missed opportunity. So when you start to speak about your health, you got to speak about your health as it will be in the future after God intercedes in the present. So I realize that I have this pain, but I already know that God is going to heal me. So it's only for a little while. I realize that my job situation is not what it should be, but it's only for a little while because my real job is coming. This is just my temporary job. You know, they used to say, when you don't have enough money, then that must be your seed. So this is just my seed job. This is my standby job.
Yeah.
I'm going to learn some skills on this job so I can be ready for my real job. because this is not my real job. Yeah. That's what we have to speak into existence. I know it's really hard with money now, but soon it's not going to be. And when I have extra, here's what I'm going to do with my extra. I'm going to give here. I'm going to do this. I'm going to go there. I'm going to write it down and make the vision plain, because I know that this is just temporary.
Yeah.
Or do we say, I don't never have enough? Are we looking, God, where are you at? I'm always struggling. My health is always bad. When you're going to heal me? The book tells us it's already been done.
Yeah.
By his stripes we are healed. So why are we asking him for something that the book already tells us that we already have? Or should we say, God, the book says I'm healed and I have this pain, but I know that you're coming,
yeah,
and I know that you're going to touch it, and I know that you're going to take it away. What's coming out of our mouth? Is what's coming out of our mouth aligned to what is in the word, or is what coming out of our mouth aligned to what is in the world? It makes a difference. And it's hard work. It's hard work when you want to have tears in your eyes and you want to give up and you want to lay down and you're really not even concerned if you get up or not, to be able to say, for you I live,
yeah,
and for you I die.
Yeah.
But God, I want to live. But I don't want to live like this, because your word says,
yeah,
that I can have better. Yeah. Right? So that's why we have to know what his word says. But I still haven't gotten to what is the wisdom and what is the understanding that they are referring to in Proverbs 4. Genesis 8 and 22 says,
yeah,
while the earth remains,
yeah,
seed time and harvest, cold and heat, winter and summer, and day and night shall not cease. So the biblical scholar Storms said there are over 8,000 promises from God in the Bible. That's a lot of promises. That's a lot of things that God has promised,
yeah,
us. But what we have to know as saints, some of those promises are exclusively for the saints, and some of those promises are for mankind. Genesis 8 and 22 is a mankind promise. It's a man. Seed time and harvest is going to come if you believe it or not.
Amen.
Right? The seeds that come out your mouth, the word that comes out your mouth, it's going to produce something if you believe it or not.
Right.
Those things that we speak is going to produce something. Right? Dandelions growing all over the place. We don't even have to plant them seeds. The wind takes it to and fro, to and fro. Dandelions everywhere. All over the world, there's dandelions.
Yeah.
And people not even planting those seeds. Some things grow easier than others.
Yeah.
What's coming out of your mouth?
Yeah.
What's coming out of your mouth?
Yeah.
Things that are important, things that need nurturing and cultivating, take time to grow. That seed is not going to grow overnight. Trash grows overnight.
Yeah.
Trash grows over. Mess around and don't take your trash out 1 or 2 days. It's piled up. You like the dump yard in your own house. Trash grows overnight. It's easy and it's quick. It's easy and it's a quick seed. But those seeds that go deep and are meaningful and are valuable, they take a long time to grow.
Yeah.
And they need nurturing. They need cultivating. I worked with a lady this summer, and she has a garden. And she was like, oh, Lisa, if you put these little plant boxes you put outside, they'll grow all by themselves. But these, you got to take care of. So you got to hold them in the house, and you got to make sure they don't have too much sunlight. And I'm like, no, no, and no. Pass on that. I said, when you get your harvest, share some with me. That's what I told her. Because I was like, that. I was thinking in my mind, she's doing too much. A whole bunch of work. She online and she looking stuff up. You gotta have this kind of soil and the pH gotta be right. If I can't just put that seed in there and put some dirt on it and maybe throw some water every now and again, I don't need to have that one, right? But when it comes to my life,
yeah,
I need to get it right.
Yeah.
When it comes to my life, yeah, I need to have the patience and the time and the knowledge that it's going to take, so that I don't keep planting seeds
that's going to grow obstacles, potholes, distraction, right? Those are the easy seeds that come up quick. I don't want to keep planting those seeds. So I got to pause. I got to get good word. I got to get good seed. But I also got to know how to plant it, when to plant it, how to cultivate it. What do I have to do? So mankind promises. That's a mankind promises. So everybody has access to seed, time, and harvest. If we're looking for a reference, if we look at Matthew 5 and 45, the B section, it says, "For he gives his sunlight to both the evil and the good, and he sends rain on the just and the unjust alike." See, that's the affirmation that some promises are for everybody, if you believe or not, right? Because it don't just rain on the just and the unjust going into drought, right? It don't just have sunshine for the good, and the evil is always in darkness. Their lives might be in darkness, but the sun will shine on both.
Yeah.
So we understand that there are some promises and there are some things that we are responsible for.
Yeah.
So when we go back to the text and it talks about that perverse speech, that corrupt speech, we have to know that those are the things that we're saying. And a lot of times we want to think they're just talking about cussing and swearing, and that's included, but that's not all that's included. It's also included the things that you're talking into existence, into your life, the things that you're looking at and you're speaking on. And just pause and think about some of the things that you have said that you wish you didn't say. Think about some of the things you have seen that you wish you didn't see. I was watching a movie the other day, and I thought it was just a regular old movie. And then it turned out to be a scary movie. So if y'all know, I don't watch scary movies. I could not find the remote. People screaming on the TV screen. My eyes was closed. I'm in the room with me, myself, and the TV. I can't lower the volume down. I don't want to look. It was chaotic. And I was like, where is the remote control? Like, I couldn't find it. And finally I was able to, you know, put it on a different channel. But then I was like, just so easy. Things can be filtered into your eye gate.
Yeah.
And then it goes into your mind gate. And then you start thinking crazy things. And you start talking silly stuff. Just that easy. Something I seen that I didn't even know that's what it was going to be, and it kind of flipped on me, and I, you know what I'm saying? So when we think about perverse, don't just think about swearing and cussing, but think about, what am I saying that's building, developing these seeds and bringing forth this harvest? So we're still on a quest to find out, what is this wisdom and this understanding? So in 1 John 3 and 23 and 24, it reveals to us what the wisdom is. And it reads as follows. And this is his commandment, that we should believe on the name of the Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as he gave us the commandment. And he that keepeth his commandment dwelleth in him, and he in him. And hereby we know that he abideth in us by the Spirit which he has given us. Do you know Jesus? The knowledge of knowing Jesus is the wisdom. But the foundational text speaks of wisdom, which is the knowing, and then it also speaks about the understanding, which is the doing. Many people know of Jesus, but where many of us struggle and stop looking straight ahead and get sidetracked and distracted by evil is by the doing. This morning, Mother Kyra talked about when that fervency
and that joy starts to diminish. When you're doing this work over and over, and maybe we really didn't cultivate our seeds correctly. So we said some words over here, and we got some sprouting. But then we said some words over here, and they done choked the life out of the sprouting because we wasn't able to cultivate this, and we kept growing this. Matthew 4 talks about those seeds that we throw on stormy ground, right? What is the ground that you're putting those seeds on?
Yeah.
Right? With certain things we see growing, ivy can grow everywhere.
Yeah.
Everywhere. You don't have to cultivate ivy. It's gonna grow. Let a little piece get there into the root. It's gonna grow and grow and grow. There's some things that will grow into the walls of your home.
Yeah.
Right. Right. You ain't gotta water it. You don't gotta go out there and water it. You ain't got to put shade over it. The sun don't burn it up. It just be growing and growing and growing. The knowing and the doing. So yes, now when we look back, what are we keeping in our heart? We're keeping in our heart who Jesus is and what he's done for us. But that's the knowing part. The other part, the application of the word of God to our lives. And here is the qualifier: in all situations and circumstances. I want to pause, because if we say some, many of us can step forward. All, every situation and circumstance. So I don't know about you all, but I've had some rough situations and circumstances.
Yeah.
And I can stand before you all and say, I didn't plant good seed. I didn't plant good seed. I was angry. I was mad. I was bitter. And I was like, why me? That's how I was. Right? I had some situations that had my back up against the wall. And I'm like, I don't understand. Why me? Why not somebody else? Why not this person over here don't even believe in you? Get them. Right? Get them. Let them be the example of hardship and frustration. I'm just keeping it real with you, right? It's real talk. Right? Because this is how I talk to the Lord. Why me? Why not him? He over here acting a fool. And you giving him a pass. He just passed. Just passed. And you got me ride, people riding my back for nothing. And I said, you know how long I've worked on this tongue not to snap off on folks? Is this the test? Is this the test? I said, because I don't know if I'm going to make this test here. I might have to go back to the first, the starting line and start again. But thank God he don't make us go back. He just said, girl, start where you at. Start where you at. Just keep moving forward. Just start where you at. Reset right there. Right? Because it's true. And we try to pretend like it's not. But that's real talk. That's real talk. Right? And we looking and we seeing. Right? David said, I almost. Right? Because we be like, I'm just waiting. I'm just waiting. Right? I'm just waiting. Can you turn that Christian music down? If my eyes could roll any harder. Why are you bothering me? Go away. Go somewhere else. You always got to talk to me before work, and then I got to turn my music off. And you have nothing to say. Nothing. I start scrolling on my computer. That really means you goodbye. Right? They act like they don't know. Distraction. That's all it is, distraction. I want to come in happy, and you want to make me sad. Distraction. So that I forget. Forget the word. Forget what I'm trying to cultivate. Forget what I'm trying to do here. And I'm like, when is the day going to be over? Is it summertime yet? I'm looking for summertime and school just started, right? Distraction. Distraction. Y'all laughing, but I'm so serious. I'm like, when's our last day? When is the last day of school? Because I am. I'm telling you, I can't. It has been such a week. I sat in my office one day and I had to start laughing because I'm like, this sure enough got to be warfare. This is warfare 101. I'm like, I got to pull up the bootstraps. I said,
that because they coming for me. For real, they coming for me. And I'm like, I'm telling my kids, y'all don't understand, folks is coming for me. They and just whatever. They're like, whatever, mom, right? Folks, that's how folks is coming for me. I'm like, this cannot be, it can't be this bad. I'm like, this is a good school. What's happening here? Yeah. But I digress. I'm gonna go back to the text, right? Applying that word, all circumstances and all situations. Here is our David and Goliath moment. Understanding is more than just knowing Jesus. It's applying who he is in our life, every moment of every day. In John 14:16, Jesus told him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And the implication of this passage in our life is that we got to get this thing right. We got to get this. We got to get the more than just knowing him right.
Yeah.
We got to get the application of his word in all, every situation and circumstance in our life. All, every situation and circumstance. Every time your feelings get hurt, what is the word that you're applying? Every time you feel sick, what is the word that you're applying? Every time your money is short, what is the word that you're applying? All. When things don't look right, what is the word that you're applying? All means all. And we have an all or nothing God. And that's where people start stumbling and falling and getting distracted. Because we think we can't do it. And I'm going to tell you something. You can't do it by yourself. You can't do it by yourself. But because God knew it was an all or nothing, and he's such an awesome God, he never leaves us or forsakes us. If we go to St. John 14, the 21st through the 23rd verse, those who accept my commandments and obey them are the ones who love me. And because they love me, my Father will love them. And I will love them and reveal myself to each of them. Judas, not Judas Iscariot, but the other disciple with that name, said to him, Lord, why are you going to reveal yourself only to us and not to the world at large? Jesus replied, all who love me will do what I say. My Father will love them, and we will come and make our home with each of them. Anyone who doesn't love me will not obey me. And remember, my words are not my own. What I am telling you is from the Father who sent me. I'm telling you these things now while I'm still with you. But when the Father sends the Advocate as my representative, that is the Holy Spirit, he will teach you everything and will remind you of everything I have told you.
Yeah.
That's why we can do this all or nothing venture. Because we're not doing it alone. He didn't just say, in every circumstance in your life, I don't care what the circumstance is, apply the word, grow the seed, do it on your own. And he's sitting back to see. He was like, she gonna need help here, she just need the Holy Ghost inside of her, because she ain't gonna be able to get off the starting line if she don't have help, right? She may be able to get off the starting line, but 1 mile in, she getting ready to buckle at the knees. When that distraction comes at 100 miles an hour across her path. So I'm going to send the Holy Ghost. I'm going to send the Holy Ghost
that is going to bring to her remembrance the things that I have said. The over 8,000 promises that they have access to. I'm going to send the Holy Ghost so that they don't have to struggle by themselves. But they will have an advocate that will fight on their behalf, will remind them, will help pick them up. And that's why I don't have to go back to the starting line. You go to the starting line if you want to, but I don't walk too far, so I don't care what mistakes I made. I'm getting up from where I am and planting new seed. I'm not going back. I'm not starting over. I'm not that person. Even if I slip and fall, I'm not there. I'm here. I'm here. And he lives inside of me. And he works on me daily. Because I'm just going to be, Friday, I was like, yeah, I'm going to get me another job. I'm going to call this recruiter. They've been calling me. Yeah, I can make more money. And I had a worker. She must have called me Friday and left a message. I didn't pick up. She called me Saturday morning. She said, Mikhail was there. She said, I called you and I left you a message. You didn't call me back. I was just hoping that you wasn't packing your boxes up and getting ready to leave. Didn't say a word. I said, oh, I missed your message. She said, you know we don't want you to leave, right? I said, what did you want? Because I didn't listen to it. She said, this is what I want to do. I have an idea to help us. Because I'm short teachers, y'all. I'm short teachers. And you can't teach kids if you don't have teachers. So she said, this is what I can do. So she came up with this plan. And it was really a good plan. And she said to me, this is what she said. This is how I knew it was the Lord. She said, Lisa, I don't even care if they don't pay me any extra money. I don't even care if I don't get an extended contract. She said, I'm willing to do this, and I just want to make sure that you're going to stay. Right? That was Jesus. Because I was serious, y'all. I'm like, let me call this recruiter. I don't have to do this. I got to work, but I don't have to work here. I tell people that all the time. I have to work, but I don't have to work here. I said, let me go somewhere else. At least it's got to be crazy. Let me make double the money for crazy, right? I'm just saying. And she called me, and I'm like, okay, God. Okay. You know, I had a very emotional moment with a student. Y'all, they was fighting. I think I was in shock. Because I'm like, it's not even 7 days yet. And they was going for broke. And then I was like, I gotta get in between them. Y'all, that's why I got damage on my fingers. I was gonna pull the whole nail off, right? I was like, man. And then the girl said, she said, Miss Richardson, you better let me go. And I held on to her and I said, I'm not gonna let you go. I'm not gonna let you go. And she started to cry. And I started to cry. And we both was crying together. And I was like, no. No, because our babies are hurting. Yeah. They're hurting. And they talked about this in Sunday school. I don't have to walk around with a Bible in my hand, but my actions better show love and compassion. My actions better show that I care about somebody other than myself. And even though she was tearing up my school and my hallway was a wreck, I stood there with her for about 20 minutes as she cried and sobbed and sobbed. And I said, this is hard work. This is hard work. I need extra seeds for this work because this is life and death work. This is the work that will change the trajectory of somebody's life forever when they know somebody cares about me. Somebody loves me. It makes a difference. It makes a difference. And I just thank God. What is your level of applying the word to your life? Many years ago, people was wearing those, what would Jesus do bracelets? What would Jesus do here? What would Jesus put that bracelet on so you can remind yourself, right? Then they get mad, they take that bracelet off, they don't even know where it is anymore.
Wow.
The psalmist is warning us that knowing Jesus and applying his word keeps our feet free and our words will not be pervasive. They won't be cutting down, tearing up. It will not be taking us off track. 1 John 3 and 1 says, see how very much our Father loves us. For he calls us his children, and that is what we are. But the people who belong to this world don't recognize that we are God's children because they don't know him. All the world knows is that we're different.
Yeah.
They can't put their finger on it, so they are relentless in making us and wanting to make us like them. The world uses pressure. They use shame. They use guilt. You always going to church. You should be spending that time with your kids. That's why your kids this. That's why your whatever. They use guilt to create potholes and distractions in our life. You got to pray every day. You got to read every day. Or when you know that's what you need and you try to go there, here they come. They come in herds. You can't even, sometimes you feel like your mind just like, I just need a moment. You know, our bishop talked about having to go to the bathroom with the psalm book. It's just so chaotic. They're so chaotic. The world is so chaotic. Nations are falling before our eyes, just like they said in the word. The weather is changing just like it said in the word.
Yeah.
It's chaos everywhere.
Yeah.
And they always want to encroach on our peace. The peace that they didn't give us. And they can't take away. But here they come, trying, pushing, pushing. This is not your peace. I'm going to need you to back up. Y'all used to tell them, that's why I don't do elementary, y'all. Because the elementary kids, they like your clothes, right? The older kids, when you start walking in their way, they start shutting up. They don't want to talk no more. They want you out of their space. They want you out of their bubble. The little kid, Miss, come over here. Miss, can I hug you?
I was like, ooh.
Encroaching on your space in the elementary school. That's what they do. So Miss Richardson says she's going to go over to the middle school and the high school, right? I sit at the table at lunchtime. You can hear a pin drop on that table. Well, what y'all talking about before? Keep talking now. No, miss. No, miss. Everybody quiet now. Oh, everybody quiet now. But well, I'm going to the next table then, right? That's the world. That's the world. They know they didn't give you that peace. You come in happy, joy, joy. Here they come. Here they come. But they can't take it away. But we can give it away. And that's what I had to learn. Stop giving those people your peace. You came in happy, then you should leave happy. But they know they can't take it away, but we sure can give it away. So they come with us with that pressure and shame and guilt, and then they create these potholes and distractions, and then they go around their way.
Yeah, they do.
Eating and drinking and having a good time, and you there to suffer. A focused faith is knowing Jesus and applying his word in every circumstance.
Yeah.
Take a moment. Close your eyes and imagine what your life would look like through the lens of St. John 10 and 10. The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly.
Yeah.
Just pause for a minute. Think about that. Here's the thief. He's coming to steal your stuff, steal your joy, your money. He's coming to kill things in your life, those seeds that you have planted and you spend your time cultivating. He's coming to kill them. He's coming to destroy it. But then there's Jesus.
Yeah.
Then there's Jesus. He's come so we can have life and we can have it more abundantly. What does more abundant life look like for you? Oh, let's shift on over to Romans 8 and 28. Let's imagine. And we know that all things work together for good to those that love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose. All that's all things, y'all. Let's think about that.
Yeah.
All that mess that's percolating. He said, even that mess I'm going to use. Even that mess I'm going to use. He said, all things are going to work together.
Yeah.
And before I close, I just want us to consider Romans 8, 35 through 38. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake, for because of Christ, we are killed all day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. That's the world's view.
Yeah.
Yet, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loves us. That needs a hallelujah behind it, church. In all these things, in all this tribulation, all these trials and perils, when the world, because we call the name of Jesus, they want to kill us daily. Every day, all day long, he said, yet, yet. He said, because of all that stuff, yet, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angel, nor principality, nor power, nor things present, nor things yet to come, nor height nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. We need a hallelujah. Cultivate your seeds.
Yeah.
Worship God.
Yeah.
And watch your life change. Yeah. Hallelujah. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Come on, clap your hands in here for that word. Come on, clap your hands. Come on, clap your hands. Plant your seed. Come on, clap your hands. Plant your seed. Hallelujah. Come on, now lift those hands. Amen. Amen. We want to water that word right there. Amen. You water the word with worship. I want you to think about the places in your life now where God has sent the word and things have come to distract you from that word. But it's time to refocus. Come on, with your mind and your spirit. Refocus. Now I want you just in the secret, private place of your heart, I want you to tell God, speak to my heart. Tell him, say, speak to my heart. That's right. Come on, tell the Lord. Not me. Tell God. Say, speak to my heart. Say, give me the words that'll bring new life. Hallelujah. Speak to my heart. Holy Spirit. Give me the word that will bring new life. Words on the wings of the morning. The dark clouds will fade away. If you speak to my heart, speak to my heart, Holy Spirit, get message of love to encourage me, lifting my heart from despair. How you
you love me, you care for me, speak to my heart, speak to my heart, Holy Spirit, give me the words that will bring new life, words on the wing. Speak to my heart. Speak to my heart. Speak to my heart. Come on, that's what we want to tell them. Speak to my heart. Speak to my heart. Give me your holy word. If I can't hear from you, then I'll know what to do. I won't go alone. I'll never go on my own. Just let your spirit guide and let your word abide. Speak to my heart, Lord. Give me your holy word. If I can't hear from you, then I know what to do. I won't go alone. I'll never go on my own. Just let your spirit guide and let your word abide. Speak to my heart, Lord. Give me your holy word. If I can't hear from you,
refocused. The Bible has given us explicit instructions. It says that if we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus, and if we believe in our hearts that God raised Jesus from the dead and that his death was the payment for our sins, the Bible says we shall be saved. Even want to talk to you if you're backslider, if you had a real close walk with the Lord and for some reason or another you have strayed away from him, the Bible says that he is married to the backslider. That is, because you have walked away from him, he will not abandon you.
Yes,
but the Bible said, whosoever cometh to the Lord, he will in no wise turn him away. You don't have to worry about God not receiving you when you make up your mind to go home. Just like the father of the prodigal son, he will be on the road there waiting for you. He'll have the fatted calf. He'll put a new robe on you and give you a ring, signifying that you are still a vital member of the family of God. Amen.
Yeah.
Clap your hands right there.